I know this makes me sound like an asshole, but I'm pretty convinced that not every single dime piece female sport broadcaster slash analyst knows what she's talking about and is being told what to say in order to attract a larger audience. How in the hell is Michelle Beadle's tired, old, wore out, unenthusiastic ass the highest paid female sports broadcaster? That's disrespectful to all the other female sport broadcasters that still give 100% and don't mail it in on a nightly basis. Ugh. Kendall Coyne Schofield has the voice of a 12-year-old. Sounds awkward and simply unlistenable. You're joking, right? Hi, my name is Chelsea Vern, and I'm a woman pursuing a career in sport. I currently go to Ryerson University, and I'm going to be graduating with a professional communications degree and a minor in sport marketing. I also have many part-time jobs, one with the Toronto Maple Leafs, Toronto FC, Toronto Argos, the National Hockey League, and Ryerson University's athletic department. I conducted a study on gender bias in sports where broadcast and digital media were the primary sources of my research. I focused on two groups, current female professionals in sport media and post-secondary students looking to follow in their footsteps. Let's take a look. I hypothesized that gender bias continues to be a significant barrier for women in the sports industry. Key variables in this study are negative stereotypes affecting hiring positions, promotions, and opinions of women pursuing careers in sport media. My questions were centered on gender bias within the sports industry, the education system, and attitudes of the general public. This issue is worth studying because there is an increased awareness of historic gender biases in the sport media landscape. Many women don't realize a career in sports is a possibility for them, nor are they given the equal opportunity to pursue one. More evidence needs to be found to prove that further actions must be addressed. My hypothesis was proven to be correct for this study. Gender bias and discrimination practices are continuing to occur in the sport media industry. It is seen in the workplace, in the classroom, and within our social circles. In the ways discussed next, we can see a positive movement forward, but we have a long way to go. We can see improvement, but there are baby steps that take too many years to implement, whereas these steps were always a given right to men. So, there is no reason for a woman to battle with tremendous effort to obtain a natural right. Pay equity. Period.
Please tell me why we're still on this. It is not a debate. Men are better at soccer. No one wants to watch women play soccer. That's why they're paid less, because no one wants to watch.
Oh my God. Okay, it's happening. Everybody stay calm.
What's the procedure, everyone? What's the procedure?
Stay calm.
Biggest hurdle that women face is visibility. Having played sports growing up, you just see that you need to become a strong-willed fighter to be viewed on the same playing field as men. The results from both of these graphs show that the effort of popular sports platforms and leagues is dramatically low. Each entity is generally ranked at a moderate level, which indicates that addressing gender bias and exposing women's sports within their organizations is a low priority. The NBA is the only league that stands out as making good efforts and is coincidentally the only professional men's league to own and operate a women's professional league, i.e. the WNBA. Not only is their knowledge questioned or criticized, but when women enter or initiate a sports conversation with their male peers, they are drilled with trivia to determine their ability to be a fan.
It's funny to hear a female talk about routes.
Clearly, we have a lot of work to do, but with a persistent group of allies within the industry and throughout the public to raise awareness of gender bias, and with young generations of females standing up for themselves, we can do it. Thank you.